talking about that particular chapter is chapter 23 in the Bible. Chapter 23, verse 24. 23:24. If you're interested in the Ramban,
there shall be a Shabbason
for
you.
Right, so that's right. So that pasuk, what is the whole pasuk? How does the pasuk go? There shall be a, go ahead.
They speak to the children of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, on the first of the month,
there seventh month, first of the month, that's our Rosh Hashanah, right? Yes.
There shall be a rest day for you.
Shabbat.
A remembrance of the wailing sound, a holy congregation. A wailing sound. Like somebody's praying. All work of labor you shall not do, and you shall offer a fire offering to Hashem. Hashem spoke to Moshe, but on the 10th of the 7th month.
But, yes, on the 10th.
Is the day of atonement. There shall be a holy convocation for you, and you shall afflict yourselves. You shall offer a fire offering to Hashem. You shall not do any work on the essence of this day. What is the day of atonement to provide you atonement before Hashem your God?
Okay?
Yeah.
So what do you notice? I mean, right. He says, I'm going to explain to you the difference between the judgment on Rosh Hashanah and the judgment on Yom Kippur. You heard what this is, right? What are you talking about? Which judgment?
Well, Rosh Hashanah is Ben, Yom Kippur is Rechavim.
No, but who said that Rosh Hashanah is judgment at all? There's no pasuk in the Torah that says on Rosh Hashanah you're going to be judged. No, sir. Right? I mean, it's a zichron trua. It's a commemoration of wailing of trua of
yes.
Calling. What?
Yes, my judgment.
Yom Kippur. Ah, but Yom Kippur, it's a day of atonement, and you shall fast, and you shall not wash, and eat, and drink, and. So Yom Kippur sounds like it's packaged as a day for judgment.
Right?
Forgiveness, atonement, repentance. I mean, it sounds like it, right? But Rosh Hashanah doesn't sound like in the context of the pasuk anyway. It doesn't sound like it. It does.
It's
right?
Like a calling.
Try to make. So let's see what he says, right?
Right.
So we start on Yom. He says that we should start with Zichron. One second. Which is Zichron Trua. You see that about halfway through the Ramban. Keep going in the Ramban. You will say Zichron Trua, a remembrance of wailing. Do you see that quoted somewhere? Zichron Trua, a remembrance. No, not yet.
Yeah.
The same, this pasuk of Ramban.
Yeah.
You see it?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So on that piece of the pasuk, he's talking about Rosh Hashanah, Zichron Trua, right? So Psukei Zichronot Psukei Shofarot Lezichron Lachem Akedat Yitzchak Shekarev Tachtav Ayil, Lashon Rashi, right? So this, what he means by Zichron Trua, when the Torah says this is a day for Zichron Trua, it is a day when you should remind, that you should speak about, you should declare, right, the psukim, the verses in our Torah, which remind us of zichronot, of of memories, whatever that means, right? And psukim of shofar, to in order for what? In order to remember for your sake, for your merit, the sacrifice of Isaac by Abraham, and that in its stead, instead of it, the idol, the sacrifice was brought by the of that ram, right? That's what Rashi says. So what is the Torah? Is actually a mitzvah. This day shall be a zichron trua day for you. It's a day when you should bring up the memory for your merit of Akedat Yitzchak. Now that sounds, according to Rashi, he understands that there's some kind of judgment here, right, of the people, so that it would be useful for you to bring, you know, I'm coming to the judge, so let me bring with me a little bit of special merit, a special recommendation from me, because you know I'm not just anybody. I am the son of the son of the son of Abraham who brought Akedat Yitzchak, and God promised him then that he would take care of his children forever on the merit of what he did. So I would like you to give me some special favor in this judgment.
But it's not right. Because Hashem said, don't go on not neither to the left, nor to the right. It's like a hey.
If I'm guilty, well, of course it's not guilty because I'm not actually bribing the Kadosh Baruch Hu. You don't think that a judge, it's not right for a judge to take into account special extenuating circumstances when he's giving a sentence, usually in the courts here, somebody's guilty. Now we're going to give the sentence 5 years, 10 years, 15 years in jail. So all kinds of people are brought into the trial. Listen, this guy, you know, he's been very good, and until now he's been a very decent person. He comes from a family that is very good people, and he was, I mean, I don't know, doesn't help? You don't think it should help?
If the judge is...
impartial.
Is impartial, or not impartial, but he's going to the...
the letter of
the letter, you know, it must be.
But of course, God Hashem doesn't like to go to the letter of God.
Hashem is bad, is mercy.
It's mercy. And judge.
And judge.
Okay, so far, the Rashi. He's probably going to object to this. So it says, Vaya, if you take Rashi's opinion, Tzarich harav lehavi gam psukei hamalchiyot, min hamidrash shelo yitachen sheyazkira katub psukei hazikronot v'shofot lezkir malchiyot. Now, what's the problem here? You understand that Rashi, according to Rashi, the mitzvah of this day shall be for you zichron tshuva. That mitzvah says that in our tefillot, when we pray that day, we should include all kinds of psukim that talk about the shofar and that talk about the Akedat Yitzchak in order to remind God of our favor. Right? So the Ramban says, listen, if that's what the pasuk means, that we should do zichron tshuva, then you know very well that we're here last day Rosh Hashanah, that in Rosh Hashanah our prayer includes in the special prayer of Musaf, obviously we're talking about, there are three major brachot there. One of those brachot is declaring God king over the universe. And many psukim are mentioned about his kingdom. Then there is Zichronot, which are are all kinds of memories of how God remembered the world and so on, and remembers us for mercy. And the last one is Shofarot, in which we take the psukim of the Shofar in Akedat Yitzchak, right? So, according to you, Rashi, that the Torah is telling us how we should daven, why doesn't the Torah say not only Zichronot, Zichron Tshuva, it should say Zichron Malchut, and Zichronot. Right? I mean, if the Torah is trying to describe to us how we should daven, then there should be three.
Why does the Ramban mention Shofarot?
Oh, Shofarot is the one.
No, yeah.
Is the one that... Oh, Psukei Zichronot, Psukei Shofarot. I'm sorry, you're right.
No.
Rashi had said Zichronot and Shofarot. You see? So the Ramban saying, according to you, it should have been Malchiyot too.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Okay, mm-hmm. All right. Mm-hmm. Fine. Yeah, see that so far? The kvar dashu otam nifasuk vayalachem zicharon lifnei Hashem lokechem Yeah, and I want you to know that we already know from somewhere else, without this pasuk of Zichron Teruah, that we should mention these commemorations of old times of our nation before Hashem, because there is a pasuk, and this is the Gemara 97. Yeah, in Bamidbar it says, "Vahayu lachem zicharon lifnei Hashem elokechem." These things shall be a memory before God, your God. She'in talmud lachem. Talmud lamar ani Hashem elokechem. Umat talmud lachem Hashem elokechem. Elazeh binyanav kol makom shata omer zichronot ata somech lahem et amalchuyot. When it says zikaron lifnei Hashem elokechem, it means to say that every time you mention zichronot, you also mention His kingdom, because I am the Lord your God. Kedisa v'korim masachet Rosh Hashanah. Well. Okay, there's a little technical. Aval, he instead thinks otherwise. It's not telling us how we should daven. It's a little strange, actually, for Rashi to think that the pasuk is telling us what psukim to mention that day. Isn't that a little peculiar? Because after all, I mean, davening is unshakenness, it's a tefillah composed, and I mean, it's Mina Torah, that we should, according to Rashi, is Mina Torah prescribed that we should say Zichronot and Shofarot on that day? So he says, I want you to know that all the ideas about the Sukkim that we will do on Musaf on that day, Asmachta, you know what Asmachta is? Sort of like, we know that this is what we want to do, or we have a tradition that this is what we want to do, and we attach it to a pasuk.
Rabbinical.
Yeah, not that the pasuk actually tells us that that's what we should do. It's a way of giving it status, you know, the found it was like that. Okay. For us, we holchim l'makom shetokim, ve'ein holchim l'makom shemivarchim. So what? Oh, and I want to prove it to you. He says, if you have a choice, let's say you are sitting in town, and you know there's a place over here where there's a minyan, and they're going to daven on Rosh Hashanah, but they don't have a shofar. And I could go over there where there's a minyan, and they don't know how to daven. Or maybe there's even one person, he's got a shofar. So he's going to blow a shofar, but there's no tefillah there. So where should you go? If you have no choice, you have to make a choice. If you go to one of them, it's too far to make both. Okay? So which one should you go? See, he says you should go to a place where you blow the shofar and not to the place where you daven. Mm-hmm. So according, the Gemara there says, when they discuss this, they say, what kind of a, that's not a big revelation, because the Torah commands you to blow the shofar, and the Torah doesn't command you to daven. So therefore, of course, we should go to the place of the shofar. So according to you, Rashi, the Torah is commanding us to say those tukim, which is tefillah. So that would be mina Torah to say the tefillah. So the Gemara wouldn't there presume that one of them is the Rabbanan and the other one is the Oraita. You understand?
Right.
He's concluding, therefore, that Rashi is not correct, that the mitzvah is to say those tukim on that day. Pinky, right? No?
Well, I'm not sure what you said about my virtue. Ramban says that Rashi said, who said, Hoffman, the Mokum Shotoki, and Hoffman, the Mokum Shimavar? Who said that?
He's quoting a Gemara.
Okay.
And he says, Rashi said before, not in the Gemara, Rashi said before that the mitzvah from the Torah is to say the psukim of Zichronot and Shofarot on Rosh Hashanah. That's the mitzvah in the Torah. So he's trying to prove that Rashi's wrong. That the commandment to do those psukim is not a commandment of the Torah. It's the Rabbanan. And they just attach it to a pasuk. It's not true that the Torah commands you to say this to king. And he says, I will prove it to you. Because there is a discussion with Moreh, have nothing to do with Rashi. that if you're sitting there and you can walk 20 miles to go that way to daven, or 20 miles to go that way to blow a shofar, you should go to the shofar, not to daven. So the Gemara says, of course that's what you should do, because the shofar is a mitzvah min haTorah, and the davening is not a mitzvah min haTorah.
Why is davening not a mitzvah min haTorah?
It isn't. That's what the Gemara says, it isn't.
In that discussion there, Ramban,
a person is supposed to look to God and speak to God every day. That's true. He could do that by walking. He could 20 miles to go to this guy to blow the shofar for him.
Right. Yeah, can daven.
Yeah, there's no mitzvah. According to Rashi, the prescribed text of our musaf, two out of the three brachot, are min haTorah. That prescribed text, right? Zichron Teruah means Tzadigu Hapsukim Shel Zichronot V'Shofarot. That's what it means to him. According to Rashi, it would be min haTorah to blow the shofar, and also min haTorah to daven that musaf. So the Gemara would not say that it's so clear which one you should go to, right? You have two mitzvot to the right up, one here, one there, right? The Gemara said, oh, of course you should go to the shofar. What are you talking about? Why should you go to the place of davening and miss the shofar when the shofar is min haTorah and the davening is not min haTorah? That's what the Gemara said. So he says, according to you, Rashi, that wouldn't work out.
Right.
Oh, is that a seder? You follow? Yeah. So then the Gemara there answered that the regulation that you should go to listen to the shofar and not to tefillah is not so obvious if you're not sure which one you're going to make. Let's say, to go to the shofar, if I go 20 miles, I might not make it. Mm-hmm. I might not make it. But to go to daven, I've got just 1 mile to go. And I'm sure I'm going to make it. Right? Which one should you choose then? Right? Because if I go the 20 miles, I might not have davening, which is midirabanan, and I would not have shofar either. I may have nothing. I may have zero. So should I take something that I know I will have, even though it is lesser, and give up on the higher one because I might not make it at all? That's a dilemma. That's a dilemma.
Why are you structuring that?
That's what the Gemara structured. That is exactly what the Gemara's answer is. You asked me why I even tell you about going to the shofar and not to tefillah, when it's obvious that you should go to the shofar and not to tefillah, because the tefillah is low and the shofar is high. Of course you should go to it. So now they have to explain themselves. Why did they say it? So you know what? They said it for a special situation. When going to the shofar is maybe you will make it, maybe not, right? Or I think there's somebody with a shofar there, and when I get there, there may not be even a shofar, right? I don't know, right? Or he broke, I don't know. But I know I'm supposed to be able to find the shofar there, I might make it, right? Mm-hmm. But the tefillah I can make for sure. So then one is midirabanan, so that's a good question now. Is it so clear to us that one should go to a derabanan that you definitely have in your hand? Or you should give up that rabanan that you definitely could have in order to try to get a deoraita, even though you might not make it at all. Mm-hmm. Right? Which way should you go? So then the Gemara is telling you, yes, you should go after the doubtful deoraita. Even then, you should go for the shofar, even if you might not make it.
If you lose your time going there,
if you don't make it,
like
you don't make it.
You make it.
If you don't make it, you don't make it. Hashem, you know, we read somewhere that if you're trying to do a mitzvah and you're compelled against your will, something happens that you don't make it, then Hashem considers it like you did. Hashem gives you the credit like you did. Right. So the Gemara here tells you that that's what you should do. Mm-hmm. You stay there. But in any case, Abal Zichron Teruah Kamo Yom Teruah Yilachem. Okay, so before we do the Abal, so he now, in a few ways, has tried to refute Rashi. Rashi is not correct in saying that Zichron Teruah means to say the psukim. But say there so far, Pinky.
More or less, my eyes are tearing.
Yeah, but besides the eyes are tearing, is the brain okay?
I think so.
Okay, good. Next, Aval. Zichron tshuva kemo yom tshuva yalachem. What I mean to say when the Torah says zichron, the memory of tshuva, it doesn't mean use the psukim to remind Hashem of the tshuva. No, 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 not like Rashi. But zichron tshuva, the memory of tshuva, means it should be a day of tshuva for you. So why you say zichron? Why you say memory? It doesn't explain yet, right? Should be a day of tshuva, a day of blowing the shofar, right? Yomar, shenariya biyom hazeh, we should blow the shofar on this day. That's what the pasuk actually means. V'yelanu zicharon lifnei Hashem. Our shofar is called a shofar of memory because the shofar will remind Hashem of us. Right? According to Rashi, zichron tshuva means we should talk about the tshuva of the time of Akedat Yitzchak and the ram's horn and the Akedat Yitzchak. We should talk about it to Hashem and remind him of the memory of that tshuva so that he will have mercy on us, right? Now the Ramban says, no, no, no. We should do the tshuva, our own shofar. And this shofar will be a reminding of God of us in our favor. It's a nuance, right? A difference. So what's the mitzvah according to the Ramban? Is to blow shofar. It will serve to be commemoration to God when we blow the shofar. According to Rashi, I don't even know exactly where Rashi gets the mitzvah of blowing the shofar. But the Rashi, according to Rashi, the main pasuk here, zichron tshuva liyelachem, means you should speak about the tshuva and the commemoration of the old days to God.
Mm-hmm.
No, that's... Well, that, I don't know if you apply that to Rosh Hashanah. It says there that when you are surrounded and you have enemies and you need to remind God of yourself, then you should blow the chatzotrot. It's not the shofarot even there. You know, those are the silver... And says he's making a comparison. You mentioned that. When you are in trouble and you want God's help, then there were these trumpets that people would call out to God, and that should be a reminder to God of having mercy on you. Right? So it's the blowing that's the mitzvah. And the blowing, the sound of the mitzvah, is going to be a reminding of God to take care of.
Besides this, can I blow the shofar when I am in stress, you know, I am in a situation that need that Hashem listen to me and use the shofar?
I don't know. I don't know why not. It's not a mitzvah. But
it's not a mitzvah.
The Torah does have a mitzvah about what to do when the people are in trouble. You blow those special trumpets. But you are right that in a time of famine, when there was a, let's say, hunger because there wasn't enough rain, then they would blow the shofar on the fasting day that they established. So the shofar there again is the same idea. Yeah, right. So for a person himself, I don't know, there's no prohibition. Go, sure, why not? When you were hacked and you were very depressed that your website wasn't working, so you should take in a shofar and okay. And of course, there it also says, in your holidays, you shall blow on the chatzotrot, on those trumpets, upon your sacrifices and so on, right? And here, unlike all the other holidays, right, Pinky? This is different than all the other ones. The other ones blew the chatzotrot.
Like
this one, they blow the shofar.
That's like I'm saying.
Yeah. On this one, you blow the shofar only, without the chatzotrot, right?
Right.
Okay. And then it says, you shall offer a sacrifice. This is not the same blowing that occurred in the Yamim Tovim and the Rosh Chodesh and the troubled times, which was the trumpets over the cast sacrifices, but this one is a shofar, different than all the others. Vizot eina ala korban, this blowing is not on the sacrifice. You know, remember, it said with the regard to Rosh Chodesh and Yom Tov, it says utkatem b'chatzotzot al olotechem, right? You shall blow it upon your sacrifices. Here, it doesn't say that. Here it says Yom Shuvah, Zikron Shuvah Yelachem. It's a day of blowing the shofar. End of sentence. Then there's another sentence. And you know what else do you do that day? You bring a sacrifice of Yishe Lashem. That's not to say, that doesn't mean that you should take the shofar and blow it on your sacrifice, because there's two different statements. Right? The other one, in Yom Tov and Rosh Chodesh, it says you should blow the shofar upon your sacrifice. So it seems like when they brought the sacrifice, they would blow at the same time.
Okay.
Right?
Happy
time. Yeah. V'stam kol shuvah b'shofarai, I'm sorry. V'stam, and here, by the way, on this parsha of Vayikra, where in Emor, where he's talking about the shofar of the chatzotzot hadn't even been created yet. The mitzvah of making the chatzotzot is in Bamidbar later. Right? So it's not even here. It's not around here. V'stam kol shofar tru'ah shiriyah b'shofar hi. And every time the Torah says tru'ah, it means shofar. K'mo she'nemar v'habarta shofar tru'ah v'artzechem. That is on Yovel. Okay, wherever it says tru'ah, it means shofar. V'lo pirush hakatuv ta'am ha'mitzvah hazot lama tru'ah. Okay, now he's trying to give us some understanding of why this would be a mitzvah here, right? And he says the Torah doesn't explain the reason for this mitzvah to blow the shofar. Remember, we started this way by saying everybody knows that Rosh Hashanah is Yom Adin, but where do you get it? It's not in the pasuk. The Torah doesn't give you the reason for this truah, the mitzvah. The lamad nitznarech zicharon lifnei Hashem b'yom hazeh. Why do we need to be remembered before God on this day? Yoter mishmar hayamim, more than any other day. I need it today also. What's the difference between Rosh Hashanah and any other day? Why klal? Why should it be a holy day? After all, every one of the other holidays, there's a mention of something. Pesach, why do we have a mitzvah? Because it's at the mitzvah. Sukkot, why? Because I want you to remember that you sat in the Sukkot on the way from Mitzrayim to Eretz Israel. Shavuot, a little more complicated, but Shavuot, it's the day of the harvesting and the bringing of the first barley offering in the Beit HaMikdash. And, you know, beginning of the wheat season coming up. Okay, right? Yom Kippur, a day of atonement. It says so. Rosh Hashanah, I want you to make a holiday on the seventh day, the seventh month, the first day. And I want you to blow the shofar. Okay, now let's go on to Yom Kippur. Why? What's the mitzvah? What is the Yom Tov about? Right? It doesn't say. That's what the Ramban is pointing out, that this is the only holiday in which there's no discussion of the reason for the holiday. Right? But I want to tell you, Yipneishu b'chodesho shel Yom Kippur, this is this holiday of the first of the month of the seventh month is in the same month as Yom Kippur is. B'rosh HaChodesh, in Rosh Chodesh. It seems to me, nireh, shebo yiyeh din lefanav yitparech. So it seems that on this day there will be judgment before him. Kibam yadin amim. B'rosh Hashanah yeshev l'kisei shopei tzedek. Where does it say that?
Yao.
9? Yeah. Oh no, Tehillim, he says. Ach nirem yirsato ikar shekem gudrasha li. It's just a hint, he's saying. Why is it a hint?
It will be a judgment for him.
Why should
on them he judge people, right? This is a job.
But it doesn't say that on Rosh Hashanah. It doesn't say that about Rosh Hashanah.
No, he judges
the wrong people. We know he judges people. But why Rosh Hashanah yeshev b'kisei shofet tzedek v'achreichen v'aseret hayamim yisa l'pesha avadah? He's trying to say that Yom Kippur being there 10 days later suggests that there's two steps. If Yom Kippur is a day of atonement, that means there's first the judgment. go to the judge and he says yes, no, right? And then you have a period of time and you come back, and atonement means you undo, you get forgiven, you get the
sentence?
Kapara is atonement. Atonement is not a sentence. Atonement is
based and at the end of, we started on.
The sentence is Rosh Hashanah, you say. The judgment is Rosh Hashanah. Then there is a chance to atone. What is atone? I know I'm guilty. I'm trying to get forgiveness.
I'm trying to connect with our regular judgment.
That's not what you say. But that's not what he's saying, right?
And he hears us, and before the hearing and everything, so he gets the final say. So you're clear that Yom Kippur, that he used the 10 days to.
But that's not what he said.
No,
I understand what you're saying. I'm just trying to repeat what the Ramban is saying. Right? The Ramban is saying, I conclude that there's Yom Kippur in this month, and it says atonement on Yom Kippur, that the holiday that is mysterious, that the Torah doesn't say anything about, the holiday that precedes it, must be a day to judge, and then there's a period of time to atone, which Yom Kippur does. Because Yom Kippur doesn't say judgment, Yom Kippur says to atone. Right? And atone sounds like it's after the judgment, I suppose, no? I know I'm guilty, so I'm going to atone.
So you can have another cup of coffee?
Maybe. Why? You want to shut it off?
Yeah.
No, don't shut it. Why shut it off? Are we going to save electricity? The next half hour, I will shut it off myself. No problem. We'll go on. I might. Okay. So are you... At the end of the 10 days, then Hashem will forgive. So this hint he's saying in the pasuk is something that the Bnei Israel received from the prophets and our forefathers, our holy forefathers, that Rosh Hashanah is traditionally a day of judgment. Now it's a peculiar mitzvah. It's a peculiar Yom Kippur. You see, he's agreeing, he's confessing. The Torah doesn't say that. The Torah doesn't tell you what Rosh Hashanah is about. But we, first of all, we have a tradition. This is so from the beginning. I don't know who he means. Let's see. And also the fact that Yom Kippur is so soon after, and we're blowing the shofar, that Hashem asked us to blow the shofar, it must be connected. From Moshe, even. I mean, he's saying that that's what we always believe, that the Rosh Hashanah is a connection. That's what he said. I mean, where is Kiddushin? Where is that footnote? You see it? He's saying in the footnote here that there's a drasha that Ramban himself wrote for Rosh Hashanah elsewhere in another book, right? And it is, we have it published, that he said way back all the way to Moshe Rabbeinu, and it is still in our hands a tradition that is famous and in the Gemara and in Talmud, that anybody who understands the hidden secrets of the Torah will see this idea much more prescribed, you know, specifically in the language of the Pesukim.
Really?
And because Trua is what stands in our favor for judgment. So the very fact that the Torah tells us to blow the shofar, one hint. And the very fact that this Rosh Hashanah day is 10 days before Yom Kippur, which is the Day of Atonement, those two things suggest that if you think about it, it's got to be for the reason that we have judgment. You mentioned now, of course, you might then ask me, so if this is true, why didn't the Torah say so? Ki yom adinu. Straightforward. Why not? Did you know why not? We even have a tradition about that. Why does the Torah not say this is the yom adinu? Why shouldn't we all say?
Well, you can come with us, okay?
What's that?
I can sit here.
Please. Why isn't it so famous that this is yom adinu? So you know that tradition that. We don't want to remind the Satan, the prosecuting attorney doesn't know what date the judgment is. We don't want to keep a secret from that. I'm going to go to the judge without the prosecuting attorney there, and I'm going to bring Pinchas with me, who's going to be my defense attorney. I don't want the accuser to even know about it, right? So we'll go there, and the judge will listen to Pinchas, and Pinchas will say, "You guys are a pretty good guy. Once in a while, he fouls things up, but he really means well. So why don't you be nice to him?" And the judge says, "Okay." In the meantime, you know, the accuser didn't have a chance to come because he doesn't know the appointment. And we like that. Because if he would have come, he would have said, "Are you kidding me?" He would have said, "We don't ask it," right? So he would tell the judge all kinds of bad stories. So the Torah doesn't even mention that this is the day of judgment.
Because all you're going to my Rosh Hashanah.
Yeah, okay. Zichron, the whole idea of Zichron Teruah, why the Torah doesn't say that it's a Yom HaDin at all. There's no word that this is a Yom HaDin at all. On Rosh Hashanah, it says on the seventh day, seventh month, the first day, make it a Zichron Teruah and bring a sacrifice. Now we'll go on to Yom Kippur, talk. Nothing about judgment. See? Okay. See, right? But there's a hint that we need the shofar. Why would the Torah tell us more about the shofar if not to bring up some merit from the old days that Hashem should look at us favorably, right? Why this day and not any other day? Why not have the shofar and Pesach? What's so special about this day to blow the shofar? So that gives a little bit. And also, like Yom Kippur is coming 10 days later and we're going to have atonement. Atonement usually follows the trial. At first, you hear about how much of a peccal of guilt you have, and then you try to atone. So it must be only by hint. But it's a secret, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. So then he says, Alderich I met.
What do you say?
I don't think so.
I say, after the trial, it's too late for atonement.
I don't think so.
Mr. President. Well, no, the judgment hasn't done yet.
If you get a judgment,
they didn't
some
get a
people,
judgment.
Sometimes the judge will say, "Okay, I'll tell you what,
well,
I'm going to give you public service for
right.
You don't have to go, you don't have
that's
to go,
what we do. We do
you don't have to
service.
Go to jail, you
twice
have to
a
go
day.
To public service. Every Friday you have to go into a soup kitchen and give food to the people. and that's your sentence. Atonement, you work it out. And Hashem promises that after judgment, if you take it seriously, you bring some tshuva, I will have atonement. And He promises you're going to get atonement on your kippur after the judgment. That's what He claims. Valderich HaEmet, which we will not understand, maybe, right? Remember, this is the next part that's Kabbalistic in Ramban, usually. Tshuahi Shandala Batenu Lanu, the blowing of the shofar sound, is what has been in our favor for us and our forefathers. Shene'emar, Ashrei Ha'am Yodei Tshuah, right? Happy is the nation that knows Tshuah. And he says here in the footnote, Uma HaKatuv Hazeh Harbei Yod'im La'asot Tshuah V'Chatzotot V'Shofarot. What kind of a pasuk is this? Happy is the nation that knows Tshuah. I mean, I know my Catholic Polish partner in my practice also knows Tshuah. If he takes a Tshuah and he listens and he teaches himself how to blow, he also knows. It's this, happy is the nation that knows how to blow Tshuah. Why would that be? It's so special, right? So there's got to be something in it, a meaning to it, not just to know how to blow, right? Harbei yodim la'asot Tshuah b'chatzotot v'shofarot. There are many people who know how to blow. And they, nevertheless, are not so meritorious, and God does not favor them. And there are many people who are Jewish who don't know how to blow. How do you do? Okay, so I don't know how to blow. Put somebody who doesn't know how to blow. So he's not You're not lucky and happy among the nations who know how to blow Torah. Everybody knows that's Torah to blow Torah among the Jews. Obviously not. And yet they are beloved by God, right? Ela Trua hi midat adin. It says Trua is judgment. I don't know why. That's why they threw the shofar every time they would begin to trap. They were beginning to trap because they are worried about all kinds of dangers, and they're blowing the shofar because we're going to be judged now whether we went on a safe trip or not a safe trip. So that time was for blowing. So whenever they blow, whenever you blow for midat adin. Omer aleha kuma Hashem v'yafutzu alvecha, and that's what they said. They prayed, right? As soon as they took the aron and they started traveling, they say, "Rise up, Hashem, and may your enemies disperse," right? And so on. Okay, tireki chomati rikona flam v'yantrua. Also, the walls of Jericho fell when the Jewish part. For the pishi he atat chilat b'kibush haaretz v'asa kadosh b'kuti ed midat adin mitukha kevada. So he wanted the trua to be blown in judgment against the enemies, and therefore they would fall.
Unkelus is not only for judgment.
Yeah, and he Unkelus says that Trua also means kingdom, because we when the king wants it. Okay. Well, the Pinchas Trua midat adin amar Hashem the Trua, because it is judgment. Trua means judgment. And now we say, happy is the nation who know judgment. That mikarevet el hadat, that takes serious consideration that judgment is coming. Those are happy people. They might, it might make them shake in their pants, but those are happy people, because if you don't know that you have judgment, you will never correct yourself. But if you know there's a judge, and he's going to judge me, then you start taking things seriously. And that's what he means by Ashrei Ha'am Yodei Trua. Happy is the nation that knows the judgment is coming. Wow. Interesting. No? Happy. You would think that if you know judgment is coming, you would be very unhappy. He's saying happy is the nation that knows that. Right? Ki ha'yidia tomare tat bikut. Because knowing will bring you connected to God. Moshe Adam yada. And so on and so forth. Very interesting, right? So the trua means judgment, and it means that we prepare ourselves to understand the judgment. That's how Derek I met, right? At this time we understood that Derek I met a little bit, right? כיאן שכתיב תשורת מלך מלחמה כי השם מלחמה אם כן תשורה אני אומר להם לכם שיהיה היום תשורה לנו וכן זה קרום תשורה מלחקות שם זה קרום תשורה לתת החיה המדרש נקרא קודש ובואו תשורת לעשות משפר משפר רמז ביום התשורה בואו ביום משפרזים אוקיי, he's going to רחמים in a little moment, I don't know if we have time for that.